Hi, this is journalist Annie Gamps. I'm working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Western North Carolina. Please subscribe to anniegamps.substack.com if you haven't already. I've highlighted several congressional issues with Chuck Edwards, who currently is the congressman for NC11, which covers Lake Lore as it is today, Tuesday, April 16th. He is about to host a tele-town hall, he said on Facebook. He just announced this earlier today, the same day. There's very little knowledge of it. So we will see what he says. I shared his social media post in which he said he's looking forward to sharing an update from Washington and hearing what's top of mind for folks in our mountains. And you can call in to 855-710-6225 starting in 2 minutes at 7 p.m. So I'm going to do that with my Google Voice and we'll see if that works out so I can try to share it with everyone here. Waiting for the to begin.
Town hall. Tonight you'll hear from the congressman about issues he's working on and ways his office is working hard to serve all of Western North Carolina. The congressman will start our event tonight by speaking for just a couple of minutes, but it's important that you know tonight is a two-way conversation, and we want you to be involved in that conversation. If you have a question for the congressman, please press star 3. That's star 3, and you can do that now, and we'll take as many questions as we possibly can tonight. We're eager to get to as many of those questions as possible and hear any feedback you have for the Congress. We probably won't get to every single question tonight. We'll do our best. But if we don't get to your question, please contact Congressman Edwards' office and they'll get you a response as soon as they can. You can also keep up with Congressman on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, Congressman Chuck Edwards. That's Congressman Chuck Edwards, or visit his website at edwards.house.gov. Without further ado, here's Congressman Chuck Edwards. To take your time to be with us to discuss the major issues that are affecting our community and our country at large. In compliance with House rules, I really wasn't allowed to host tele-town halls during the election period, so I'm particularly excited to be able to resume these and connect with the people in my district in my capacity as a representative in Congress. I really have missed this opportunity. And tonight is about you. I'm looking forward to answering your questions and providing an overview of the work that I've been doing in North Carolina and in Washington. So let me hit a couple of headlines. I'll begin with the border, the border, the border. Joe Biden's catastrophic policies continue to allow millions of illegals to come across our southern border, and he's shown no interest in reversing any of the 64 executive actions that he put in place that relaxed the policies and that are allowing this catastrophe. Nor has Chuck Schumer given any sign that he's willing to take up H.R. 2, the Border Security Act that the House passed early last year that provided the most stringent border security laws perhaps in America's history. Even President Trump has come out and pleaded to President Biden and said that he had, President Biden has the authority to fix this problem, but has failed to do so and is showing no interest in that. But I and my House colleagues continue to insist on border security, and we can only hope that we can get our border secure and get our country secured even before the November election. As most of you know by now, this weekend, Iran launched a massive and unprecedented attack on Israel. And if it wasn't for Israel's air defenses and our own military's cooperation on the Iron Dome, more than 300 suicide drones and missiles that Iran fired would have killed countless civilians. I'll be backing legislation this week that supports our ally, Israel, and that holds Iran and its terrorist proxies accountable. And Iran is but one of several countries that make up a modern axis of evil. And this was abundantly clear in my recent travels to Ukraine, Poland, and Moldova. At this very moment in Ukraine, civilians are being tortured and murdered. Children are being kidnapped, and sexual assault is being used as a weapon of war. Without America's help, Ukrainians are running out of ammunition to fight their invader, Russia. I believe it's in the United States' best interest to help Ukraine in a fiscally responsible manner, and I found some ways that we can do that. And I look forward to supporting legislation to do just that. In these alarming times, President Biden's domestic policy also continues to fail the American people. The Consumer Price Index, a key inflation index, came in higher than predicted in March, increasing at an annual rate of 3.5%. Inflation, which we're all facing every single day, every time we go to the grocery store or fill up our car, is up 19% since Joe Biden took office. Finally, I'd like to address the serious and credible allegations of wrongdoing against the Department of Homeland Security Secretary Mayorkas in his failure to protect our southern border. This week, the House has sent the articles of impeachment that we passed against Secretary Mayorkas over to the Senate. Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer must now fulfill his constitutional obligation and immediately hold a trial in the Senate for Secretary Mayorkas for the safety and the security of every American. Your input and engagement in this process are valuable, so let's make the opportunity of tonight's chance to talk. Thank you again for joining us, and I'm happy to look forward to your questions and our discussion. Ray, who's got the first question tonight?
Congressman, in just a couple of minutes, I'm gonna let Bill from Cherokee ask the first question. But first, I want to ask everyone on the call, if you would like to receive email updates and communications from Congressman Edwards' office, if you could just press 1 on your keypad right now. Press 2 if you do not want to receive communications from the Congressman's office. But if you'd like to be included on his newsletter list, press 1, and they'll make sure you get added. Okay, Congressman, here is Bill from Cherokee.
Hello, Bill from Cherokee.
Hello, sir. How are you? I just want to thank you and your office for doing what you can to get my great uncle back to the United States. He was buried in Sierra Leone. He was a casualty from a U-boat. He was a merchant marine. And he's currently over there, and your office is helping to get him here back to Cherokee. So he's an enrolled member of the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians and a veteran. And I just wanted to say how much I appreciate what you're doing for us.
Bill, that is so very kind of you to say. And one of the things that I'm really most proud of with my team is how passionate that they are in serving the citizens of our district. And there have been a number of situations like this one where we were able to to find a person or remains and get them returned. So thank you for the very kind words. I appreciate that. Ray, who we got up next?
Well, next we'll have Ruth. But first, I just want to remind everyone, if you're just tuning into the call, you're on a live telephone town hall with Congressman Chuck Edwards, and you can ask a question of the congressman by pressing star 3 on your keypad. That's star 3 at any time, and we'll do our best to get to everyone's question. Ruth, you're on live with the congressman.
Hello, Ruth.
Hi there. Hi. I think I've written to you about this issue, but I don't know if you remember. It's the World Health Organization meetings that are occurring now. Some very secretive meetings. Nobody really knows what's being debated. You're not elected officials. And yet they're trying to put through a plan to make everybody in the world, obey their orders when the next pandemic or re-pandemic occurs. And I don't hear anything in the mainstream media about any of this, and yet, this sort of treaty is happening by the end of May, and I'd like to know what your office is doing around this, or you or your office, or anybody in the House.
Well, I appreciate that question, Ruth. What I have done is supported legislation to withdraw the United States from WHO. They nor any other world organization should have say over anything that we do in this country, let alone anyone's particular healthcare choices. So that's what I've done. And I think in the appropriations process last year, we ended up putting forth a resolution to defund WHO, and I expect that we're going to do the same thing again this year. So thank you for that question, Ruth. Ray, who do we have next?
Okay, and one more time, if you're just joining with live telephone town hall with Congressman Chuck Edwards, please press star 3 to ask a question of the congressman, and we'll do our best to get you on live. Congressman, next we have Joey King, who has a question about Ukraine.
Hey, Joey.
Hey, Congressman. I know you just finished a visit to Ukraine, and there's a lot of debate between the Freedom Caucus and actual conservatives that are for a strong national defense. What is your position after visiting Ukraine on providing funds for Ukrainian defense?
Joey, I really appreciate that question, and we could spend the rest of our hour talking on that subject alone. I went to Ukraine to get a firsthand account of what's taking place over there, because I think most Americans know we can't really trust the news right now. And I came back of the opinion that America has always stood against evil, and there is evil rolling through Ukraine now that none of us have ever witnessed. Ukraine is under attack by a ruthless Marxist socialist dictator. I had the opportunity to meet with survivors and victims of the horrendous acts that have been taking place over there. And I'll tell you, what's taking place in Ukraine is not much different than what we've seen with Hamas in Israel. It's just that the Soviet Army's not taking pictures of it and sending back to America, as Hamas has been. It's clearly Vladimir Putin's intention to sweep through Ukraine and begin to take over neighboring countries. That became clear to me in meeting with Moldova's president. It became clear to me in meeting with military and diplomatic leaders in Poland. They are all deeply concerned and frightened about Putin's intent. And Putin's been very clear. He said to the world Russia knows no borders. Putin has established an army base right there in Moldova. He's currently building a naval base in Georgia. And he's targeting 90, listen to this statistic carefully, please, all of you. 97% of the targets that the Soviets are hitting are non-military targets. They're hitting places like hotels, churches, apartment buildings, schools, hospitals, pharmacies. And they've been very clear that their intent is to make the Ukrainian people suffer. And Americans have never stood by and turned our back on people that are in such dire need of help. And so the vote that I will cast this week, assuming that we can get the bill on the floor, will be to help the people of Ukraine. But I also know that we can do that in a fiscally responsible manner. One of the concerns that I hear from many folks is that we're in financial trouble ourselves. Why would we be helping someone 5,500 miles away? Well, the answer to that, first of all, is that there are many sanctions against Russia that have not been implemented. And I believe that we need to go there first. There's about $300 billion of Russian assets that could be seized to aid in Ukraine's defense. And there's also the lease loan program that was used in World War II to assist folks that needed military assistance, where our taxpayers would not be on the hook for the total bill. And so, I'd also add that I don't believe that there is anyone amongst us, even the folks that are most opposed to helping Ukraine, I don't think that there's any person amongst us that could stand before the victims and the survivors in Ukraine and listen to their stories and still say, I'm not willing to help. So I probably was a bit wordy, Joy, but I appreciate the opportunity to offer that to all of you tonight. Ray, who do we have next?
Thank you, Congressman. Again, it's star 3 to ask the Congressman a question tonight, star 3 on your phone. Congressman, our next question is from Lori in Lake Toxaway, and she has a question about the border.
The Access Live event operator has been notified that you wish to ask a question.
Beautiful up there today. What's your question about the border?
So my question about, we've met a couple of times. I'm Lori Ashenfelder with EJ. As you know, we lost our son to fentanyl. And I want to know, I understand issues with Ukraine. I get it. We need to do what we can. We've got kids, adults dying in North Carolina, throughout the United States every day, and we can't seem to do what we need to secure our southern border and protect our. How do we get beyond the stalemate that sits there constantly? And one other question, which was mentioned when I originally asked, organization, you know, we try to help people in our community. I don't condone drug use, I never have, never will. But we can save lives with Narcan. I can't get my hands on it. It's too expensive for those that need it. How do we make this better for people?
Well, first of all, I'll certainly address your concern about the border, and you should be concerned. The House, as you're aware, and I mentioned in my opening comments, has already done its job by passing H.R. 2, the Border Security Act, which took some of the strongest measures to secure the border that we've ever seen. The Senate has refused to take that measure up. We continue to put pressure on Chuck Schumer to take that measure up. We continue to put pressure on Joe Biden to exercise the authority that he has to fix the problem. He's refused to do that. Chuck Schumer has refused to take up the matter. I'm going to continue to fight every single day to apply that pressure and to get the public to apply that pressure. In the House, the thing that we can do, our primary power, if you will, is to pass legislation. But it takes three particular branches of government, three chambers, the House, the Senate, and the presidency, in order to pass legislation. And then on the second part of your question, I'm a co-sponsor of the Stop the Fentanyl Border Crossings Act, and if passed, that act will restrict migration and imports from foreign countries that facilitate substantial illicit drug smuggling and prevent the introduction of illicit drugs into the United States. We know a good portion of those are coming across our border. We're going to continue the fight, Laurie, and I appreciate your continued concern and you voicing that for us. So thank you, Laurie. Ray, who do we have next?
For the next question, Congressman, we have a quick one-question poll that we want to ask everyone on the call, and you can complete this poll just using your keypad. The question is this. Do you believe that as a world leader, the United States should support Ukraine in its fight against Russia? Should the U.S. support Ukraine in its fight against Russia? Press 1 if you think the U.S. should support Ukraine, 1 for yes, 2 for no, and 3 if you're unsure.
Your response has been registered.
It's from Tony and Fletcher, who has a question about your vote on ISIS. All right. Hello, Tony and Fletcher. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. Why did you vote against the renewal of FISA and the warrantless surveillance of us Americans?
Well, so let me make sure that I'm clear, or the people out there listening are clear. I voted to renew FISA. FISA, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, Section 702, was passed back in 2008 as a result of 9/11. It has admittedly been misused a number of times by the Intelligence Committee and the community, and the number of times that I've been told that it was misused was about 278,000. Absolutely an atrocity. And they were dead wrong to be surveilling Americans in an unapproved, illegal way. The headline is, we need FISA to continue to protect Americans, but we do not need Americans illegally spied on. And so President Trump actually renewed FISA in 2018, and it since was discovered that it was being misused. And so what we have done is passed 56 different reforms in FISA 702 that would limit its use, increase penalties on those folks that did misuse it. Here's one of the things that I think most people do not understand, and there's, Tony, an awful lot of misinformation out there. FISA 702 allows the intelligence community to monitor communications of foreigners on foreign soil. It does nothing to legalize monitoring communications of Americans. What FISA 702 will do is allow the intelligence community to look at data that has already been legally collected were an American to have communicated with a known terrorist or someone that is under surveillance. I wish that we lived in a world where we didn't have to monitor what's going on overseas. I wish that we lived in a world where people were not trying to hurt Americans. I have had privy to a number of classified briefings and learned from the intelligence community of numerous occasions where thousands of American lives were saved because we had the ability to monitor foreigners on foreign soil. There's even a lot of disagreement between really smart lawyers, and I listened to as many of those as I possibly could. You know how lawyers operate. Many of them will look at a particular language and they'll interpret it one way. Other lawyers will look at the same exact language and interpret it another way. I tried in making my decision to bring that down in the simplest terms, and that is people in the world are trying to hurt us. They're trying to destroy Americans. And FISA 702 is not designed to monitor Americans, but it is designed to monitor foreigners on foreign soil. And they need, the intelligence community needs that tool in their arsenal to continue to protect our homeland. So thank you for your question. I know there's an awful lot of misinformation out there. A lot of that is coming from other House members, but that's as direct as I can be and why I supported the renewal of FISA 702. So thank you for that, Tony. Ray, who's next?
Again, if you're just joining this live telephone town hall with Congressman Edwards, it's star 3 in your keypad to ask the congressman a question tonight. That's star 3. And so next we have Joel Beasley from Burnsville, who has a question about illegal immigrants coming over the southern border.
Joel Beasley from Burnsville, thanks for being on the call tonight. What's your question?
So this is a combination of the southern border issues as well as voter integrity. So I see the reason why Joe Biden is not interested in stopping the illegal immigration across the southern border, because he's actually trying to embed those people into the U.S. and he's trying to strike down the IDs for voting as well as the citizenship for voting. And I want to know what we are possibly doing to make sure that these people that are coming across the border are not going to be voting in our elections because they're not qualified for that.
And that's a great question, and we should all be concerned about that. And actually, I've got some good news about things that that we are doing. First of all, I am a supporter of the ACE Act, the Americans Confidence in Elections Act. One of the provisions in that act is that the U.S. government will withhold funds from any state entity that will allow non-citizens to vote. The other thing, and I believe this is even more significant, is that I wrote the Equal Representation Act. I originally introduced it as the No Representation Without Legal Immigration Act, and As things happen in D.C., bills morph and things change. It's now known as the Equal Representation Act. And what that will do will ensure that non-citizens are not counted in our census, and they will not be included in the apportionment for representation. And these, Joel, are just a couple of examples of dozens of bills that we've put forth as a result of Joe Biden's failed immigration policy and his failure to secure our border. But those are a couple of key things that that we've noticed and that we are working on to make sure our elections are secure. I'd also say that there's a couple of think tanks out there that have really taken an interest in my bill, the Equal Representation Act. Heritage Action is one of those, and it currently has over 100 co-sponsors. I don't think any bill since I've been up here has gotten over 100 co-sponsors. So it's a very popular bill, and I am pretty certain that I'm going to be able to get a vote on it on the floor in the upcoming months. Okay, Ray, thanks.
Yes, sir. Our next question, Congressman, is from Charles Bowman in Brevard. He has a question about gun control.
Okay, Charles, is that it? Charles?
Yes, sir. Good to hear from you. I understand you are a Class 3 federal firearms license holder. I want to know what the problem is with the reloading component for reloading ammunition that me and my grandson love to shoot and love to hunt with. Is it a matter of components being held back due to the military effort, or is it a problem of trying to keep the ammunition out of the hands of the American public who love to hunt and fish and shooting sports?
Yeah, so Charles, do I understand you to say you're having a hard time finding a supply for reloading components?
Yes, sir, that's exactly what I'm saying.
All right, what are you having a hard time finding? Primers or powder or?
Some lead ammunition.
Hi, thank you for calling. Can I get your name and what town you're calling from?
Hi, this is Annie Dance from Rutherfordton.
Okay, and what is your question?
About infrastructure for dam safety.
All right, so
Americans that Joe Biden and others are trying to take away our Second Amendment rights, and they're buying ammunition and probably components in record quantity so that they'll have them when they feel that they need them. And you're right, I do hold a federal firearms license. I can't engage in business right now. House ethics will not allow me to do that. But I proudly, proudly hold my license, and I support almost every single protection for the Second Amendment that comes to the House floor. So thank you for being a strong supporter of our Second Amendment, Charles, and thank you for the question.
Okay, before our next question, we have another one question poll for those of you on the call. You can complete the poll by hitting the numbers on your keypad. The question is this: do you believe your personal financial situation is getting worse? Is your personal financial situation getting worse? One for yes, if it's getting worse. Two for no. And three, if
your response has been registered.
Door. Okay, Congressman, our next question is from Gene Scott, who has a question about the increase in crime in Western North Carolina.
Hello, Gene Scott. I can't imagine what your question is going to be, but go ahead and ask it.
Hello, Congressman Edwards. Just grateful that you are hosting these town hall meetings. Thank you so much for hearing everyone. Appreciate all you're doing. So more recently, I am a part of a group where I receive emails consistently on different concerns in the area, crimes, et cetera. It looks like it is between daily and every other day. I am seeing within, originally it was more like an 8 to 10 mile radius from my home. It is encroaching more and more. Now I'm seeing more like 2 to 3 miles or less where there is burglary, assault, robbery, larceny, theft. Very concerning, the increase that I'm seeing, and it's a steady rate of increase. It's a two-part question, and I am concerned that the increase in this crime could directly be related to the difficulty that young people and, you know, gainfully employed people are having with the current wage and job opportunities in terms of growth, that being able to make enough money, and perhaps people are resorting to these things. I don't know what the push is, but I just wanted to present it and ask your feedback, please.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that question. Let me ask you, in what general area do you live? Oh, no, I think you're there. But in what general area do you live? You're talking about the radius from your house. What town do you live in?
I'm right outside of Henderson and outside of Flat Rock.
Okay. Well, that's helpful. There's actually a lot of reasons that crime is up. I think one of the key reasons is the drug use and abuse that's out there today. A good portion of that is a direct result of Joe Biden's failure to secure the border. We have more fentanyl than ever coming across the border. It's much more available. And as folks become addicted, they start taking more and more actions, illegal actions to obtain those drugs. I think that's probably the absolute number one reason. And then as far as your second question, and I'm going to pause here real quick to see if it's... Okay, I'm back. There are actually, Gene, lots and lots of jobs out there right now. Good paying jobs. In fact, Pratt and Whitney will be hiring a total of about 850 people, averaging in the neighborhood of $70,000 a year. The key to people taking those jobs is really their willingness to increase their skill level, pass drug tests, and show the aptitude to want to do better for themselves. And I'll make this offer to anybody that you know, and anybody that's listening out there. If you know someone that is willing to work, willing to apply themselves, and looking for a better future, me and my office stand ready to learn more about their story and help them put together a personal development plan to get them into a better job. I've made that offer over many, many months. A few folks have taken advantage of it. some don't. But I believe we've got opportunities out there for people that are willing to really apply themselves. But you should be concerned with the level of crime. I am too. You may have recognized that I held the first ever anti-crime summit over in Asheville, and have published subsequently a number of op-eds that address what I believe needs to take place on a local level, which is truly paying police officers, actually prosecuting criminals, and quit playing fast and loose with the statistics. A number of times I get reports coming from one particular area in the district where folks try to portray that everything is okay. But when we talk to people, and I talk to people like you, it's clear that it's not, that we're concerned. And I also need to call everyone's attention that most of the sheriffs in our district, in North Carolina's 11th district, believe that they are a border county because of the drugs that are coming in and the increase of crime that they see as a result of Joe Biden's failed border policies. A great, great question, Gene. And safety and security is at the top of everyone's mind. Ray, who do we have next?
Thank you, Congressman. Again, if you're just joining us, you're live on a telephone town hall with Congressman Chuck Edwards, and you can press *3 at any time to ask the Congressman a question. We'll take several more questions here tonight, starting with Annie from Rutherfordton, who has a question about infrastructure.
Hello, Annie.
Hi, Congressman Edwards. This is Annie Dance. AnnieDance.substack.com is my Cops in Congress newsletter. So I've been following what you do closely. And I cover the Lake Laura area predominantly. I understand that with redistricting, Rutherford County will fall off your district. So I'm curious on how that lies with the new congressman or woman coming into that role. And specifically for Lake Lore, they have a number of infrastructure projects. I know there's a FEMA grant, and they have several very, very serious infrastructure issues. I'm wondering if you can speak to that. I understand from reading the town's meeting minutes and following it closely that there's maybe several things in the works, but I believe when you and I last spoke, there was possible federal legislation also coming to possibly help them. Thank you.
All right. Well, thanks. Can I get you to ask the first part of the question first? The connection was fading out.
That's part of the problem in the woods here. Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I got you good now.
Hi, I was saying this is Annie Dance. AnnieDance.substack.com is my Cops in Congress newsletter. I follow what you do closely. I cover the Lake Lore area predominantly. So my question is about infrastructure, specifically for dams, and also with the congressional districts shifting, what do you foresee any issues with that as Rutherford County moves out of the 11th district? Thank you.
Well, I'm certainly going to miss the folks in Rutherford County. I've been welcome. Always enjoy visiting Rutherford County, and I've made many friends. I hope to maintain those friendships. As far as the infrastructure, particularly as it comes to dams, I don't see a lot changing with the change in the district. North Carolina is 11th district is home to more than 750 dams, each of which are vital to flood control, water conservation, and hydroelectricity, and recreation. Let's be honest, we like to play in those lakes around those things, too. I've introduced a bill that ensures America continues to prioritize and invest in dam safety, and Western North Carolina citizens can stay safe for years to come. That's been a high priority of mine, particularly because we have, like I said, 700 and
and 50 dams in NC-11 alone. So I don't see anything changing there. It's going to remain a priority.
We have one more poll question for everyone who's listening on the call tonight. You can answer just by using the keypad on your phone. And the question is, do you approve of the president's handling of illegal immigration? Do you approve of the president's handling of illegal immigration? Press one for yes, two for no, and three if you are undecided. That's one if you approve of the president's handling of immigration, two if you don't, and three if you're undecided. Congressman, we've got time for just a couple more questions, and we'll start here with Sarah from Murphy, who has a question about Speaker Johnson.
All right, Sarah from Murphy, what's your question about Speaker Johnson?
Well, I don't really have a question about Speaker Johnson. I have a question about your constituents and why they continue to want to have chaos in the House when, you know, it seems like, you know, we had chaos and Kevin McCarthy got kicked out, and now there's rumors that they want to get rid of Mike Johnson that I think is doing a pretty good job. What can you do to bring some semblance of normalcy and stability to the House?
Oh, my goodness, Sarah, if I had the answer to that. What I am doing is continuing to try to communicate with people like you and those people on this call to help them have a real understanding of what's taking place in D.C. because there's so much misinformation out there from the folks that are trying to interject chaos. The other thing that I've been scrambling to do is to talk to many of those individuals, try to understand their perspective, try to get them to understand my perspective, and above all, to recognize that we have to work as a team. We have a very divided government now. The majority party, the Republican Party, which is looked to for leadership, has an ultra slim majority, a one seat majority right now. And so to get anything of substance done, we should behave as a majority. And I think you very adequately pointed out that we've not been doing that. And by not behaving as a majority, I feel that we've failed in many ways the American people. And so I continue to advocate for us sticking together and passing legislation of substance, and us all understanding that we're never all going to get our way. That's something that most of us learn very, very early in life, and that's certainly the case when you're dealing with 435 House members. My goal is to try to help make things better for the people back in the district, even if it means that I don't get everything that I'm asking for at that time. I take what I can get at the time and get up the next morning and fight to help people's life get better. That's a great question. It's a great observation, and I wish there were an easy answer, an easy solution. So thank you for that. Ray, what do we have next?
All right, trying to squeeze in two more questions, Congressman. The first one is from Kevin from Burnsville, who has a question about threats to agriculture in Western North Carolina.
Hey, Kevin from Burnsville, what do you grow?
Congressman, currently growing beef cattle and hay, but used to grow burley tobacco, so farming was instilled with me at a young age. And as you well know, farming is well rooted in Western North Carolina.
Yeah, no.
So I guess my
I appreciate you growing things, because I developed this habit a long time ago that's tough to break. It's called dip.
Absolutely. I think we'd all agree that's one habit that we don't want to give up. And that's my concern, As I stand here in the pasture this evening with the cattle, yeah, I guess let the cattle listen in on your town hall this evening as well. But obviously, farming in Western North Carolina is presented with a lot of challenges right now, as it is all over America. Rising input cost, lower cost for goods on the farmer's end, and availability of land is becoming a challenge not only here in Western North Carolina, but across the state, across the nation. So I've got a two-part question. Number one, what legislation or what has been done in Washington to support farmers in Western North Carolina and North Carolina, but also to secure our farmland across the state of North Carolina?
Yeah, well, and I appreciate that. And in all sincerity, Kevin, I appreciate you sticking with agriculture. That is a tough business, as you know, and you take on incredible risks to help make sure that we're all fed and clothed. And I appreciate that. One of the biggest things that I think that we have to look to right now is the risk that that China brings in buying up our agricultural land, and that puts a higher, even if they buy agriculture or farmland down in the eastern part of the state, like they have many, many acres. In fact, I think they now own about 384,000 acres of American agriculture land, which is up about 30% from 2019. It increases the price and the demand for farmland everywhere else. And so I've co-sponsored the Securing American Agriculture Act, which was introduced to protect our supply chains and our agriculture land from China. It would stop America's top foreign adversaries, which are Iran, North Korea, and China, and Russia, from purchasing United States farmland. And that was highlighted in a recent Senate Agriculture Committee hearing. So that's one of the things that I think we need to look to. The other thing is we've got to make it easier for people to continue to be farmers. There are more and more rules and regulations and being placed on the backs of our farmers, and it makes it very difficult for second, third, fourth, seventh generation children to want to continue to be farmers. And we've got to make it easier for farmers to continue to own their land instead of taking what sometimes is the easy way out and selling valuable farmland to solar farms or housing developments. But thank you for the question, and thank you for being a farmer. Ray, let's take another one.
One more question, Congressman, and it's about Israel.
Okay, who are we going to talk to?
Congressman?
Yes, hello there. What's your name?
My name is Carol. I live in McDowell County, North Carolina, and I am concerned that we're not standing up and, you know, defending Israel as a Christian. I'm really concerned because I'm a King James Bible reader and believer that if we don't support Israel as a nation, you know, we're doomed. So I'm really concerned that our president and a lot of our, you know, representative is not standing up for Israel. What's being done to help maybe make sure that we do support Israel?
Well, Carol, I appreciate that question. And we know the Bible says that those that don't support Israel are going to be cursed. This Congress very much stands behind Israel, and you're gonna see a number of bills this week condemn the actions of Iran and help fund the defense of Israel. We had a bill on the floor several weeks ago to help fund Israel. It unfortunately failed, but I believe the cinema is far, far different in the House right now. And you're going to see substantial support for Israel on the House floor here in just the next couple of days. You know, one example of that is I co-sponsored House Resolution 768, and that goes to condemn Hamas in the strongest terms and expresses our unwavering support for Israel and its right to defend itself against Hamas and its the other terrorists. But I wish I was able to answer this question for you next week. I'd have a lot of really good news for you, but at least right now, I can assure you we're having a lot of conversation on the House floor this week. And then just today, we passed H.R. 5917, Strengthening Tools to Counter the Use of the Human Shields Act. And that bill will enforce sanctions against terrorist organizations that use civilians as human shields, as we've unfortunately seen over in Israel and Gaza. So great question. Please stay in touch. Watch what takes place. And I invite all of you, Ray, I don't know if we've said this yet or not, but I invite everyone to subscribe to my newsletter to stay more up to date on the things that are taking place here in Washington, D.C. And you can do that by going to edwards.house.gov.
Yes, sir. I know if you're still on with us, don't hang up quite yet. I know the Congressman has a closing remark or two that he wants to share, but we just want to say thank you to everyone who joined in this live, interactive telephone town hall. We covered about a dozen topics tonight, from Ukraine to dam safety to gun control to spending to the southern border. As you can see, no topic is off limits to the Congressman, and I know it's important to him and important to his office that you have a chance to hear directly from him and give your feedback and just be an active voice in your community and your government. So before we say goodnight, I'll turn it back over to Congressman Edwards for one last remark.
Yeah, thank you, Ray. Let me just say thank you to each and every one of you for joining the call, for staying on the call, for giving me an opportunity to answer your questions and tell you a little bit about what's going on in Washington, D.C. There's so much that we work on your behalf here in Washington, D.C. that just doesn't make it back home. There's an awful lot of misinformation that you see spread, and I enjoy and really appreciate the chance to spend this time with you. And I hope that you'll stay in touch for our next tele-town hall. So with that, I just wish you all a safe and happy and restful evening. Thanks, everyone. Good night.
Well, there you have it. That's what Chuck Edwards said today. And I have Otter here going because with this tele-town hall, if you are deaf or mostly deaf like I am, there's no real easily accessible way to access that information, to see that in a visual way, to if you have any sort of disability. So while I commend Chuck Edwards for hosting this, I wish he had it with a video that had easy closed captioning. I think that would have been a better solution. But again, Chuck Edwards does have an opponent in November, Representative Caleb Rudow, who's currently a state rep, is the Democrat nominee who will face Chuck Edwards in November. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you next time. Again, please subscribe and share my content and follow me on social media. Thanks. See you next time.